Garth Barfoot, welcome back to my podcast.
Yeah, right. Well, we're glad to be sitting down.
Well, we're into it. And at the time we're recording this, it's just a couple of weeks after the 2024 New York Marathon, which you finished at the age of 88. What was your time?
11 hours 23, something rather.
11 hours 23, and you were the you went viral. I read about you on the internet on various international publications because you were the oldest finisher in 2024.
Yeah, my son said to me, "I don't know why you got so much publicity, Dad." And I said, "Well, it just seems to come."
How old is your son?
He's 50.
Yeah. Now, this is the really cool thing. So, is he a runner? Because you ran your first marathon at the age of 54.
Yes, that sounds right. Mm.
Yeah, I find this, it's such an honour to have you back on the podcast because I find you super, super inspiring because 54 is quite late for someone to be doing their very first marathon. And here you are. It's just given you this whole wonderful, exciting chapter in your life. Here you are, 88, still doing it. And I thought about you even before New York a couple of weeks ago because a friend of mine, his dad's recently turned 81. Mm-hmm. His dad's in a rest home, basically doesn't want to be alive anymore. He's on like a cocktail of like 30 pills a day, keeping him alive. And here you are, 7 years older than that, kicking ass.
Yeah, well, that's the way it goes. It's just one thing leads to another. And you know, all the last, 20 years, I've probably been shedding activities which I can no longer do. But I've still got running left. Mm. You know, I get too cold now if I swim. I was a very keen triathlete. I've done 20 Ironman or something like that, impressive. And the cycling, I'm losing my balance a bit. I have to go to Pilates sessions 3 times a week to make sure I don't trip up. I still trip up, but not so much. And the traffic on the roads. So I've really had to give away swimming. I've had to give away triathlon. And I really had to give away the shorter distance races because I'm too far back in the field. And I've almost had to give up on marathons. But if you look hard enough and your pocket's got a bit of money in it, you can find them overseas. Not many of them. New York is one. It didn't used to be, but it is now. And Honolulu is another. But there's not too many that you can do it. I was almost resigned just to do half marathons, and those half marathons had to be part of marathons because that meant I could be quite slow in a half marathon and not keep the organisers waiting because I'd be waiting for the full marathon people. So I've got that.
Oh, so in terms of looking for marathons you can do, you mentioned Honolulu and New York. Is that because they've got a generous cut-off time?
Yes, but they both – Honolulu has always promoted itself as a no cut-off time. And New York, it was very hard to find what the cut-off time was. like a lot of events, the organisers like to give themselves a bit of leeway and not be caught by someone doing it. But it doesn't always work because we tried to do Rotorua because I hadn't done a marathon for a long time. I'd started but not finished. And my coach said, "Well, come on, we've got to do one that we can finish." And so we organised to have people walking with me, pacers, if you like to call them that. And so we, and the organiser was very pleased to see me. And so it turned out that I did that in about 11 hours 40. And the organiser, director, was waiting at the finish line and gave me a finisher's level. But of course, he's the boss. He can do what he likes. But of course, he employs people to take the time. And they'd roll up all the mats. So I never had an official time. Oh. So as far as I was concerned, I hadn't finished the marathon. Oh. So we were a lot more careful for New York. And we looked out to see what times they put in. And New York, they were putting in people at 11 and I think 1 or 2 at 12 hours. Mm. So I knew I could not just get permission, I could get a finish, and that was the trigger.
Yeah. So this year's New York Marathon, if I've got my information correct, it's the biggest world marathon on history. 55,646 people, I believe.
Yes, I think they said something like that. It's very close. So just a few more than Berlin.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's a huge mass participation event. Where were you in that? How close to the end? Were you last, or was there people behind you?
Oh, that's not a very polite thing to say. Come on.
Oh, sorry, here I am. You're coming to a podcast and I insult you.
Yeah, well, the biggest thrill for me was I beat someone in my age group. So I beat one person my age group, and I think about six people out of 55,000.
Yeah, and
I don't count the ones that don't finish.
No, as you shouldn't. When you're at the tail end of the field in a big event like New York, which is I've run New York myself, and it's so well supported. Like from start to finish, there's just a sea of people on the side of the roads. Do the people stay out? Is there a lot of cheering and a lot of support for the athletes at the tail end of the field?
Well, we're in the middle of the race, you can't wait for the crowds to thin out because the noise is, you get very, wears you down a bit.
Does it?
So much cheering and noise. But it's sort of a bit the opposite at the end because there's a rule in the race that people can't join you on the course.
Mm.
So I had two pacers who had to qualify in their own right and do the race. They stayed with me, but what I call my finishing party. I think I had 12 people cross the line with me. So, and they couldn't have done that if there were big crowds everywhere.
Mm.
But there were so few people around that I think the organisers took the view, well, if Gus got 11 people looking after him, we don't have to worry about him.
Mm.
And so, because it's quite dark, it finishes in the Central Park, the last 2 kilometres. And, of course, the street lighting there isn't anything like the street lighting on the main roads. But at least they didn't have to worry about me. But I found the last couple of kilometres, I thought, all these people are helping me. I can't let them down. I can't let them down. And according to them, I was stopping a lot. And when I stopped, I always made sure there was a wall or a post or something that I'd lean on. And according to them, I fell asleep. I didn't fall asleep, but maybe I was sort of trying to get a bit of brain power into my head to do the next 100 metres. And so it's like 100 metres at a time. And, of course, when you're going as slow as that, the finishing line never seems to end. And it never seems to come. And it was made worse because when you're finishing in daylight, well, there's plenty of signs how far to go. But when you're finishing in the dark and, you know, the crews have packed up the big signage, so there's no big signs saying, you know, 2K to go, 1 to go, 150. And but there were the occasionals. And when you asked the people at the aid stations, and they were still there, of course, they give the answer in miles, which then had to be translated. And my brain wasn't working then. Not that it works very well anyway, but it just couldn't make it. And then you got differing things. And of course, often it was sort of self-censored by the people you asked the question, self-censored. Because if they wanted to encourage me, they would say it was not far or quite a bit of distance down.
Yeah, they'd say, almost done, almost there.
And if they gave me the true distance, I said, oh, you can't be right. You must have made a mistake. But they were right. No, I was wrong. It just seemed to be endless, those last couple of kilometres.
Yeah, I can't imagine how I mean, just first of all, like 11 hours on your feet for anybody is a
lot. Yeah, but it wasn't
long.
Just 11 hours. I mean, my start time was 9:30 in the morning, but my alarm clock time was 4:00. And I had to be 4:00 because the bus that was arranged for us, which carried the elites, if you like, was you had to be at the bus stop at 4:30. The bus left at 5:00, but you had to be there at 4:30 so they could check you off and things like that. And so then when we got to the start line, so we got there about half past five or before 6 o'clock, and I still had 3.5 hours to wait in an open area with a what Google calls a feels-like temperature of 0 degrees. It was actually 2 degrees, yeah. But you know how they cut it down.
Yeah,
and that was really worried. That's where I borrowed everything, and you know, I had come prepared. I'd bought two big, thick coats from the Salvation Army shop in Birkenhead. Two, not one, two thick coats and endless stuff to carry. Mm. And then my friends had got blankets and things wrap over me.
Yeah, because a lot of people wouldn't be able to fathom this if you've never done a big marathon, like one of the majors like New York. But the logistics of getting 55,000 people to Staten Island, the start area, you need to be there a long time before the run starts just to get everyone organized. And then you're just sort of sitting around waiting, and it's a real, you can really lose body temperature. Yeah, last year you ran New York and you didn't finish it, right? Because you got too cold.
Yeah, well, that was a killer, if you like. Yeah. I mean, and I didn't have any support. I had supporters, and they said, "Oh, we'll do the race and then come back and walk you in." Well, they did the race all right, but they couldn't come back because you can't go against a string of 55,000 people. Mm. It's just impossible, and you're probably not allowed anyway.
Yeah, I think that's called also they were registered runners.
Yeah.
But you can't, you just can't. It's not like the Auckland Marathon. That's you right. can't yeah, just no. jump onto Tamaki Drive and do a couple of kilometres. Yeah, the support crew that you're talking about this year, so one of them was your daughter, Kerry.
Yeah, I got the idea from people at my age, the oldest runners from the year before, in the year before that. One thing they had in common was that they both had what I call children, but they were obviously, say, 50 years of age because they're 80. Mm. And they both had them supporting them. And so I mentioned this to my family, and I managed to get one. He said, yes, so do I. So that was fine. Mm. So that was Kerry. I won't say she retired from Barfoot and Thompson, where she was a director, to assist me, but she was there to assist me, and that was very useful. Mm. And she was a bit bossy about it too, and that helps. You know,
it's funny when that happens, eh? How you're the parent, so you boss her around for all these years, and then the roles change, and suddenly she's bossing you around.
That's right. Yeah.
It was actually Kerry that connected us a couple of years ago when you did the podcast for the first time.
Oh, okay.
She's great. She's a very big fan of yours, isn't she?
Yeah, sorry, I don't know.
Yeah. So she did that. She was there with you the whole hour.
Yeah. So she had to qualify, and, you know, and get in, and everything else. You know. Yeah. Yeah. So that's good.
So what happened last year? You retired cold after what, 30 kilometres?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Yes. I learned from that. So other people discarded their clothing as they warmed up, but my crew carried them. They carried big jackets.
Oh, just in case you required them again.
Yeah, well, I knew I'd require them. Mm. It was a certainty that, yeah, so. Mm. So, you can see in the photos of people, my other pacemaker, Leigh Cunningham, she was carrying a jacket over her arm. That jacket, for Garth. I mean, you know, I mentioned it was a bit like D-Day. Enormous preparation. You know, Churchill and Eisenhower, they would leave nothing to chance.
Yeah.
And that was really my policy. But the other thing that I had in common with D-Day was that the operation was successful. Mm. And that's all I asked for.
Yeah. Is this the most, I mean, you've done heaps of marathons, eh? Like 40 or something. Is this the most satisfying finish you've ever had?
I thought it was the closest to non-finishing
really?
I'd ever had. Yeah, yeah. I said to my crew, when the finish line, I could see it, and it only seemed about 150 meters away. And I said, "Oh, can you just stand back now? You can do it. I'll do the Queen, and you can do the Prince Philip stuff." And so then I started to accelerate, and I only got about halfway, 40 meters perhaps, and I couldn't keep going. I had to go against the side of the fence and rest to get my speed up for the next 50 metres. Mm. There was nothing left in me. Though it wasn't any particular injury, and I think it was tiredness. And what I hadn't factored in, I suppose, I feared it, but I didn't know how to overcome it, was the sleep the night before. And that was, you know, I reckon I had less sleep the night before than any other night in history.
Mm. What, nerves?
Yeah, yes. Mm. Oh, yes. So, you know, I thought, well, I've done these races before. I shouldn't. But, of course, the more you think about it, the more you think. So I rang up my daughter in the middle of the night and said, have you got any of those pills that you take before you go to sleep? And she says, I have, but it's too late to take them, Dad. You have to take them before you go to sleep.
Yeah, you might take it like a Zopaclone or something. You might take it and just not wake up.
Yeah, so I didn't. It was, yeah, but I must have slept a bit because I had a dream. Don't ask me what the dream was. Mm. Nothing to do with the race.
And
how? So that's a long time, if you like, waking at 4, performing, if you like, the 11:30, that's 11 and a half hours, you know, for an 88-year-old, even without sleep, even with sleep, that's quite a long time.
Yeah.
You know,
I found the year I did New York, so you finish in Central Park and they give you your medal, they give you a banana, give you one of the emergency blankets, and then I had to walk all the way back to my hotel in Times Square. Did you get a ride back to your hotel?
Oh, well, I had 12 people with me. So
they carried you.
Well, what happened was I thought, I only got to get to the finish line, and because it's just in the distance. And as I got closer, I thought, oh, what's that just behind the line? And I think, oh, it's a wheelchair. Oh, hooray! I didn't have to do anything. I just had to get the line. And as soon as I crossed the line, people put their arms under me, and put me in the wheelchair. And took me straight to the medical tent. I don't know whether I should talk about that.
what was the medical tent? Just to check? Just to make sure your body temperature
was
good?
Well, obviously they thought I was pretty decrepit.
Right.
Which I was. And probably I felt cold to them, so they took me and they put me under warming blankets, warming sort of sheets, and took my temperature. And after about 5 minutes or 10 minutes, they said, oh, no, you can go now. Nothing wrong with you. I mean, they asked me, you know, symptoms, but I had absolutely no symptoms apart from being very tired.
And then how long after finishing did you get to sleep? Straight back to the hotel and to bed?
I wouldn't think I fell asleep straight away because you're saying, I mean, I got interviewed for television or something where they were right on the finish line, really. Mm. So it was reasonably chatty for that.
Did, you love a camera, don't you?
Oh, yes. Yeah. I haven't spent all my life in real estate to be a shining angel.
I get the feeling the attention or celebrity or whatever you want to call it you get from running and sporting events is more gratifying to you than the career stuff that you had. Would that be fair to say?
Oh, well, it's like a new job. You know, and so, and that's what you feed on, really. I mean, you look for things that haven't been done, you know, or age records. But of course, you know, I wasn't an athlete. As you, I think you said in the preamble, you know, my first real race was when I was 54. You know, 88. That's a long time.
Yeah, and I think it's super cool as well because for anyone that's lucky enough to get to their 80s, a lot of the time you're kind of invisible from society. Like, you know, you're just sort of done, aren't you? Yeah, and the fact that you're out there and you're doing this amazing stuff that most people, like 99% of the population, will never run a marathon in the first place, and you're doing it at 88. It's really cool.
Yeah.
It's neat, hey. What did the training look like?
Well, I've got to give credit, and not to the particular retirement home, Bert Sutcliffe, but to the culture, if you like, of the retirement homes, is that they take the time make a saving thing. They put in time-saving things. So you don't have to do the grounds, you don't have to do this, don't have to do that different thing. And so it's a lot easier to have a sort of structured in your training.
Mm.
So I can say, right, I want to do, 5K round trip to coffee every morning, or always do 10K a day, or try and do 15K a day. And there's no garden. The family have all grown up, and they're almost all half a century old, so they can look after themselves.
Yeah. We'll talk about that, because last time I had you on the podcast, you were still living in the house, and this is the house that you'd lived in your entire life, which is funny for a real estate man, because
entire marriage.
Yeah, entire married life. Yeah. So you and your wife, you bought the section, built the house, and lived there for 50 years. You still had the house, and you were looking, I think at that point, at moving into a retirement village.
Yeah.
And you were stressing out about downsizing and what you'd need and what you'd throw out and stuff like that. So you've all moved in.
That's right. No, we've been there for a year and a half.
Mm.
So
how's that? How was that selling the house? Was that sad?
Oh, I don't know. I think I got more publicity than anyone else in New Zealand for for the price range of the house. it wasn't. But then I got a bit more publicity when I couldn't even get I couldn't even get government valuation. I almost couldn't get half government valuation. Mm. So it was just one of the ones that got affected by the big storms that we had in February, with Cyclone Gabriel and all that sort of thing. So,
because it's right by the water.
Yeah.
Oh, did some of the section erode or something?
Yeah, though I didn't lose any land, I certainly had a lot of inconvenience, and the council land that separated me from the sea slipped away. So, of course, the danger was more than water. Eventually we sold it.
And you had it for 50 years, so I'm guessing you sold it for a tad more than what you...
that's right, yeah.
you weren't losing too much sleep over
that's
it.
That's right, yeah.
And you've started taking up Pilates recently.
Yeah, no, well, what was happening was that I was... anyone can have a fall, but not many have regular falls. And... my coach, Michael Stales, said, when you fall, Garth, you fall like a rag doll. There's no sort of counteraction to the fall. And so he or someone else persuaded me to go to Pilates, which I just regarded as a fad. I didn't even know what it was. You know? It's like people listening to podcasts and can go faster. You know, it's a bit of a fad, but keeps you in money, so I'll go along with it.
Yeah.
But I didn't know what it was. But that was, and that and it really got so bad that the ACC sent me a letter suggesting I'd take a course in exercises. I didn't like doing exercises. I was quite happy doing training, but doing exercises in a room was just something quite foreign to me.
Mm.
I didn't have a bar of it, but anyway, that was enough when I wasn't, especially when I was hard to finish. And the ACC, of course, were concerned with the money they were spending on patching me up.
Mm.
And I became known in the doctor's rooms. So
What do you? So you do Pilates? Do you do any like stretches or exercises in your room? I've had Arch Jelly on the podcast, who's 102 years old now.
Yeah.
He still does squats every day.
Does he? Yeah.
Squats.
Yeah. Well, no, I much prefer walking to the coffee bar every day. That's more like me. And then I can talk. People talk to me.
Yeah. And so the falls that you're talking about, was that when you were still doing triathlons? Is that like falls off your bike, or are you talking about like tripping when you're walking and running?
Well, certainly once I stopped doing triathlons, it got worse. I suppose I stopped biking because my balance wasn't as good and my erection time wasn't so good. So. I just happened to be doing, but it was when you start, I tripped over on Arewa Beach. I mean, how many people have ever tripped over on Arewa Beach? That's a long, flat beach. And what there is one of the drainage from the streets. It's the regular drains, and there's a bit of sort of slime had developed where the downpipe, the drainpipe hit the beach, and I just slipped on that, you know, and that was when I decided I better do something about this, and it's worked.
Do you find this aspect of aging like incredibly frustrating?
Well, by the time you get to 88, you can accept everything.
No, but last time I had you on the podcast 2 years ago, I suggested to you that maybe you look at dropping back and doing half marathons or 10Ks. And do you remember what you said? You said, "I'm not a wimp."
Oh, well, there we are. Sometimes I make mistakes.
But I mean, yeah, here you are. You're 88 and you're still doing it. And also, I did some research by New York standards. You're still very young. The record for the oldest finisher ever at New York is 96.
Yeah.
So you're a kid.
Yeah. They changed the policy they didn't used to record the people doing that. I don't know whether they did or not. Mm. But so I thought, I only got to get to 89. And at that stage, that seemed to be the oldest finisher. That was Colin Thorne of Whangarei. And I thought, well, that'll make a good headline, you know. Mm. So, and then I looked up, I did, thanks to Google, I could work out when Colin Thorne was born. And he was born in April and I was born in May. So it wasn't much use getting to 89 and completing it, because he'd be older than me, so I had to wait till I was 90 to actually be older than him.
you're still quite competitive, eh?
Well, it's I don't know when it's left over from work. You've got that sort of competitive sort of feel at the back of things. I've got trouble, you know, running without a watch, and I've had. My watch is gone. I've just got a new one coming. I'm going to pick it up on my way home. Not so satisfying. I like a watch. You've got to measure the time. It makes my wife a bit frustrated. Garth, must you look at your watch before you take me out, you know? Priorities.
How old's your wife now?
Now she's a few more days of being a year younger than me, and then she'll be the same age as me.
I mean, what does she do in terms of physical activity?
She's had more physical problems than me. And she uses a stick now if she's going to walk any distance or time. And I was determined not to use a stick because they're not allowed in the New York Marathon. Mm. I didn't want to get in the habit of using a walking pole. Then again, I don't do the more tramps on uneven ground anymore. I just don't want to get in the habit of using a stick. Well, that's prohibited, you see.
Yeah. So New York's not your last one? Are you eyeing up another marathon already?
Well, at the finish line, I said, I finished my last marathon, but... by the next morning, and everyone said, "Yeah, good idea. That's good. That's good news, Garth. That's what all the family said." Unfortunately, I told them that, and now I've got to think of a way of saying, "I'm thinking of doing, you know, let's say Honolulu in a fortnight's time, 3 weeks' time." But just seeing what I can get into it.
Yeah, because so we're recording this, like, say, I guess 2 weeks after New York, and just last week when we were messaging backwards and forwards, you'd come back to New Zealand and you did a 5K run last week. You're just always looking for the next event, aren't you?
Well, I've done so much training that I don't know what else to do. Well, you know, like, it's not like my wife. My wife, she can pick up a book and, you know, and sort of what I call nestle down on the carpet in the lounge and read a book, you know. Whereas, I don't seem to do any reading until about 3 hours into the flight, you know.
Are you just what's known as an active relaxer? You can't sit still.
Oh, I like that phrase.
Yeah, an active relaxer. Got to be doing something.
Well,
Yeah, it's funny. Like, it wouldn't have been diagnosed at any stage through your life, but maybe it's very well diagnosed now. I think called ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. I think it is. Yeah. You had that as a child, and it was just never.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, it served you well though. Do you miss the? I know you're a massive fan of tri sport, eh? Do you miss the swimming and the cycling?
Well, I can't do it really. The coldness is quite something, and I can, I don't recover from it very much. And I did introduce a rule for the tri club that if you're over 85, you only had to do one lap instead of two of the run. But that was too difficult for the computer to handle. So once you don't get your name in the results, the inclination to do it's a bit weaker.
Yeah. And how have you found the publicity and the attention this time around?
I think I thrive on it.
You love it, eh?
and this lady at coffee this morning, and she said, "Oh, I read this bit about the paper from you." And I said, "Well, where did you see it?" And was that the article? And no, she said it was like a follow-up article. You were just mentioned in an article about exercise for older people. Mm-hmm. And it was near the end, and it mentioned Garth Barfoot in 88 doing that. I said, "Well, where did you see it?" And she said, "Oh, it was yesterday. I do a lot of reading on Sunday." Where was it? I said, "Was it the Herald? I've got the Herald. I can look through it." No, it wasn't the Herald. Probably the Listener. Oh, yes, they have articles about, there. They could fit in there. No, it wasn't the Women's Weekly. I've been in the Women's Weekly. No, about the Listener. Where can I see that, you see? And she said, "Well, they have it for sale at Paper Plus in Birkenhead." So on my way home for my coffee, I went to Paper Plus and I looked at the price, and it's very cheap to me anyway, virtually free. But I looked at it as I stood there. I couldn't find any reference that I read it. I mean, flicked the pages. I thought, well, there's no point in buying it because there's no articles in it about me.
Yeah.
So I thought, I'll go back to her. I knew she was still at the coffee. So I went back and she was still there. And I said, "Oh, look at the list. I can't find it, you see." "Oh, I'm sure I read it." I said, "Was it online?" "No, I don't read things online, you know." So anyway, so I said, "Well, I'd like to know. I'm having a podcast with Dom Harvey at 2:30. I'd like to know, and then I can bring it into the conversation." She hasn't got back to me.
I Googled your name. There were quite a few articles online. Yeah. I think one of them was like the World Running Magazine.
Yeah. Runners World.
That's awesome.
Yeah, no, that's
so cool. I mean, who could have, like, before the age of 50 when you were, I think your first marathon was 54, the Rotorua Marathon. I think you started by doing Round the Bays.
You got a good memory.
Yeah, an in-house thing for, like, Barfoot and Thompson. So, I mean, you're a middle-aged man before you even started this stuff. Now you're in your late 80s.
Yeah, that sort of hits a note with a lot of people, and especially with their children, because they used to sort of tell their parents. I remember it was Mother's Day was the day after an event, and they said, "Would you like to say a few words?" So I said to them, "Well, when you go home, tell them a story about me." That's their Mother's Day present. I offered to pay an entrance fee for the next triathlon or whatever it was. That's a Mother's Day present. If Garth can do it, so can you.
It's really neat because I'd imagine most people that are listening to this are probably under the age of 54, and a lot of them may not do any activity, and it just goes to show, listen, you can start now, and good genes and a bit of luck, you can still be doing amazing stuff in your later years. It's really cool. Hey, let's go all the way back. So you're born 1936?
Correct.
Yeah. What are your earliest memories of being a kid in New Zealand in the 30s and 40s?
Yeah, well, I really had no memories until I started to go to primary school. And my first memory of anything, because I was the youngest of four boys, was, that was, 1941, I suppose. And that was when the fear of the Japanese invasion was quite, very prevalent. And like we dug a air raid shelter, which was a trench in the back garden. That was pretty common. And my elder brothers put me in that, and then they pretended to go away and leave me, and I couldn't get out. And I started to cry. That's my first memory.
Oh, that's a terrible first memory. Oh, that's horrible.
I've got another one. And then first day at school, or seeming like that, and I did a number two in the classroom. I suppose I wasn't used to it, you see. And my memory is the teacher taking it all in a stride and coming along with an empty chalk box of sawdust and discreetly putting it on the evidence.
Oh.
So, I mean, those are my memories from my childhood. There must be others, but there we are. They're the ones that stick out.
That's so nice that the teacher didn't embarrass you.
That's right. No.
It's wonderful.
Because I suppose I was so young.
How's your bowel control now? There was no incidents in the New York?
I'm always reassured because it shows I've got life. There's life in my body. It still works.
Yeah. I heard a story about you. I heard many. I heard that you didn't you and your brothers didn't wear shoes growing up because your mum didn't believe in shoes, or they thought they were bad for your feet.
Yes. No.
What's the story there?
Very strong. They had these days. You'd have probably called them alternative lifestylers. I mean, my father works in an office, but it was, we had that sort of genes.
Like a hippie.
Yeah, sort of slightly like that. And so we bought milk from the milkman, the farmer milkman, if you like, because my parents didn't believe in pasteurized milk, and we had ducks instead of hens because they thought duck eggs were more healthy. I think it's the early days, I suppose, of hens were kept in coops and ducks could wander around the section. So it was a bit of that.
Free range.
Yes. And then my mother, we had cows on the reserve, and which my mother milked. Rather than time for it. So we had a bit of that, and we never had white sugar at all. That was a sinful food. I remember being quite shocked when I was probably about 12 or 13 and I went into the office to see my father and I was quite shocked to see him put white sugar in the tea. Of course, no white sugar. We always had raw sugar. And of course, wholemeal bread. And I had these sandwiches at school, which my father, he was quite division of labor. He didn't, he made the lunches. And that was a wholemeal bread. Well, the white bread had stabilizers in it and tasted fresh. The wholemeal bread didn't, and it got stale a lot quicker. So it got so bad one day I threw my lunch away and brought it to the shop. But, nowadays, like, gee, thanks to my father making lunch for four boys,
Yeah.
That was, I'm sure that was ahead of its time,
Yeah, it must have been. And you wonder if, your mum's thing about the ducks instead of hens and the white, the aversion to white sugar and things like that. You wonder if that's played a part in your longevity now and your good health in the later years.
Yeah, well, I can't say because I own quite a few long living in my forefathers, so certainly hasn't done any harm.
No, and your dad is the Barfoot from Barfoot and Thompson, which has been just a wildly successful business for 100 years now, almost, right?
Yeah, no, over actually.
Over 100 years. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he took over a real estate agent and then he met Mr. Thompson and it became Barfoot and Thompson. And then when you left school, you joined the firm as well, and that's where you spent your entire career. What else did you want to do? Did you have to go into the family business, or did you want to do any other career?
When I was at secondary school or in the primary school, it was just after the war in 1949, and rents were controlled very severely. House prices were controlled, and Moscow was the shining example of socialism. And my father thought, well, there'll be no future in real estate agency. So he didn't give me any encouragement in those years to go in. But once the National Party got in 1949, then things started to change. And then he was quite encouraging after that. Mm-hmm. So, but I was always the only one in the family who talked money at the dining table. We were taught never to ask the price of anything. That was crude and rough.
You know? Really? Why so?
Oh, well, it was just rude to talk about money. It was just a sort of custom. Well, custom in our family.
Yeah.
Because Judy's always, that's my wife, she said, you start, Garth, I was going to do this. And I said, I can't start. She said, why not? Well, it's just the cultural thing. I just inherited it from my mother. We weren't allowed to start until she, the cook, was ready to sit down. Mm. You know, it's a sort of, I just can't get rid of the habit.
Mm. And when did you finally retire? You worked quite late, didn't you?
Yeah, I retired when I was 81. I just wanted to get to 80, so because I thought I'd be bored when I retired. So.
Yeah, again, it's like we're talking about before, about you being an active relaxer. You need to be doing something, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know, but... then they got me to, they introduced this concept of 4-day week, which was unknown, not what it was, about 10 years ago.
Mm.
Now it's just a word, that's come into the language, a 4-day week, you know.
Yeah, and I heard another story about you. I heard, like, when you were working, you were a creature of habit. Like, you went to the Hollywood Bakery and you got the same meal, lunch every day.
That's right, yeah.
What did you have, like a ginger slice?
Oh, you're pretty up to date. Yeah, no, that's the current one.
Oh, is it? Yeah, I love my ginger crunch too. It's beautiful.
You know, I just smile at them. Smile when I go to Standing Room Express. So, and
yeah,
they sent me the same.
Is retirement you've been retired for like 8 years now. Is it what you hoped it would be?
I don't know. I can say hoped because I never really looked forward to it. I thought how lucky I am to be able to have. I say to people, you know, aren't I lucky? It can be raining and wet. And I can still go to the office, and there my secretary will produce a nice cup of coffee and a smile. You know, you don't get that when you're retired.
Yeah,
that was the day before retirement homes had coffee bars, of course. Now they do.
Yeah, especially in, I suppose, like your last decade or your last 20 years of work, was the social aspect, was that a big part of it for you? Just being around that community of other people.
I'm sure I got more sociable as I got older.
Mm.
Maybe it gave me more confidence, people. And I was used to, interviewing people. I think I worked out, I interviewed 2,000 people.
Wow.
So I got quite good at talking with strangers and talking with podcast hosts as well, you know.
Yeah. Oh, no, well, you're a great guest. There's a reason you're a repeat guest on the
that's right, yeah.
On the prestigious Tom Harvey podcast.
Yeah, okay.
And what were you like at managing people? Were you a tough boss? Were you firm but fair?
Well, it was always a partnership. So it was always, and it we. I think the firm got the. We played to our strengths, I think, and you know, I had a reputation for having a good memory, and interviewing people. It was my job, really, and other people. And my father used to say, people thought Mr. Thompson, as we called him, he was the the hard man and he was the soft man, but actually he said it was more the other way around. Mm. So it's just impressions people get.
Yeah. And you've been you're one of the nicest people I know. You're terrified of like negative publicity, eh? I remember I've told the story so many times to other people. So last time you came on the podcast, I had a studio set up in the spare bedroom at home, and it's right next door to the New World. And I said to you on text, just park your car in the New World and next door. And you refused to park there because you didn't want to be busted for like using their car park when you're not shopping there.
Yeah,
right, I love that story so much.
Yeah, a lot of people don't see they see the thing that irks them, but they don't think through. By taking away that thing, you may well create another thing that's worse or just as bad. They see the complaint, and they see that's the solution, but they don't think through the solution. Mm. Everything's got a downside.
Yeah.
You see, I mean. Politicians must get very hard road for them to travel, you know, because they get praised for things that people like, and then maybe, you know, then they get criticised for things people don't like. But it's sometimes they're part and parcel of each other.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yeah, and I suppose there's that tall poppy thing in New Zealand as well, where people are looking for an opportunity to bring you down for something.
Oh, well, it's good publicity. I mean, publicity, isn't it?
Yeah.
Whether you like it or not.
It's better to have publicity for finishing the New York Marathon at 88 than using the New World car park when you're not shopping.
Yeah, it's like my son's comment, you see. He sort of wonders, you know, do I get the publicity, you know, because I'm so well known? Or, you know, is that fair on other people who've done the same thing? No, I can't answer that question.
Yeah. I mentioned on social media that you were coming back on the podcast, and I've got some questions from people for you.
Oh, real questions.
Yeah, real questions.
Real questions. Not like when I was being interviewed by 1ZB, and they'd sort of make up a few questions that we can ask them to you. No.
Oh, did they make up some questions?
Well, they asked me to, because they wanted to.
Oh, they asked you to write your own questions?
Yes.
I'm like, what? Oh no. Well, I can, Garth can back me up on this one. He had no part in writing these questions.
I mean, so that's what I said. You notice I said genuine questions.
Yeah. What are some of the biggest changes, good and bad, that you've seen in New Zealand over your life?
Ah, okay. Well, I would think it's the attitudes that I suppose it's the attitude that I like, I suppose, sort of changed or don't like. But that's the change. I mean, I can remember when I was an adolescent, I suppose, a young adult, and we had one of my friend's future wife, my brother's, and she worked in the hospital. And she reported that they had a Dutch girl work in the hospital, and she got pregnant and she wasn't married. And she can see my eyes are watering as illness. Rather than tell her parents, she committed suicide. So you can't sort of... Yeah, I mean, it's only a story, but it's that's the attitude that's changed, you see. You know, people would commit suicide rather than tell parents that they were pregnant.
Mm.
You know, it's sort of...
Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah.
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 I can tell that still touches you deeply. It's a heartbreaking story.
Yeah.
Looking back on your career, what are you most proud of?
Oh, well, of course, in terms of the Barfoot and Thompson, I'm very pleased to see it prosper and get a good name. You know, I've sort of shared in its success, really. You know, and you know, that So that's been a great satisfaction. And then, of course, you know, I've been blessed with a wife and three healthy children, you know, and they've done well. So it's all, you know, I've got to look back with a, I can say, life of satisfaction.
Yeah, your kids, Kushla Curry, who ran the marathon with you, and Henry.
Yeah,
so they're all grown men now, grown adults now. And you say you're blessed with a good wife and good kids, but I saw some quote on social media the other day, and it said the most important things in life, things like good relationships, you know, with your family and your kids, they are things that no amount of money can buy.
Sure.
So the point of this article was that the best things in life and the most important things in life, they're available to everyone, but you got to have the only way to get them is to work for them.
Yeah.
Like it's you just can't buy them.
Yeah.
Mm. So the relationship that you have now with your kids and your friends and your family, that's just a credit to you, I think, as a man, and the work that you've done over the years.
Mm.
Hey.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm. You all right? Yeah. That's an emotional story before.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you quite an emotional man these days?
Well, I don't think of myself like that. I can remember when our first grandchild came, and it was almost I thought my wife is having a hormonal change, you know. I mean, I didn't have that strength of feeling at all, you know. They were there, you know, and they were great and all that, but it was the change in her attitude was so, you know, I thought, it must be the hormonal thing, because I'm not a very good biologist. It's probably got nothing to do with it.
I find, I reckon I went maybe like 30 years without crying much at all. Like I could probably count on one hand how many times I cried, at my nana's funeral and a couple of events like that. But in, I think it's like a male menopause thing. I cry all the time now. I'll see a sad episode of a TV show and I'll start crying these days.
Okay.
You must be quite a tough bugger, like the sort of endurance things you're doing, like the Ironman events that you've done over your 70s and your early 80s and now the New York Marathon at 88.
Yeah.
Like you need to be made of some pretty tough stuff to be doing that, I think.
Well, I suppose you could read that into it. I'm not conscious of it, but I don't know that. Yeah.
What would you say are the most important lessons you've learned over your 88 years?
Oh, I think be slow to judge, really, and because you know this it's seldom there aren't two sides to every problem, so you don't want to sort of have that knee jerk reaction. Maybe decisive leaders have to have knee jerk reactions, but. I'm a bit more cautious. Yeah. I think I learned that from my mother. She was slow to judge, if you like. She didn't rush in to anything.
Mm. Yeah. It's a good trait, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm. How do you stay positive and motivated at your age?
Well, I suppose I play to my strengths. So I follow the things that I'm better at. And if I'm better at them, hopefully I might be better than someone else. And so that's the, the icing on the cake.
Mm.
But if you're better, you know, you're playing to your strengths and got to look around a bit, see what your strengths are.
Mm. Yeah, what are your strengths and what are your weaknesses?
Well, of course, you know, getting old, you know, you're fighting this memory loss, really. But I know I can't really do anything about it. Just have to work my way around it and play to the strengths that remain.
Mm. Yeah. I think Wow, I think your memory is quite remarkable.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you notice? Do you notice? Obviously, I mean, you know yourself better than anybody else, obviously. But yeah, do you notice it declining?
Well, when I worked for Barfoot and Thompson, we might have had perhaps 1,000 employees, you know, and I used to pride myself that I knew, I won't say I knew most of them, but I certainly almost most of them, you know. And then suddenly I go to Ryman, that's the retirement town I'm with, and I thought, oh, well, I better try and learn the name of everyone in the retirement home. But I couldn't. And the more I tried to learn their names, the less I was successful. So, well, you're trying to do too much, you see.
Wow. Jeez, you're hard on yourself, aren't you?
Yeah, well, I could when I was younger, but I don't know, like... In the commercial life, there was one person at once. Mm. Suddenly you meet with 500 people and they all look rather the same. They've all got white hair.
Yeah, you must be, are you like a big deal in the retirement village? Like the fact that you're, I'm guessing no one else in the Ryman retirement village is doing marathons, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, I stick out that. Yeah. And when I first came there, I was a bit shy about wearing what other people called sponsored clothing.
Like
a friend of mine, we stayed with them one weekend, and she said, a friend of my wife's, and she said, oh, don't you people have any clothing without names on it? Well, you've got clothing with a name on it. I've got clothing with a name on it. In fact, my undershirt. It's got a name on it.
APS Insurance. Well, I'm even worse than you, mate. I've got one with my own name on it. It'd be like you wearing a Barfoot and Thompson shirt.
Yeah, well, I didn't organise it, but my daughter did it. Just, we used to arrange for all my supporters to wear Garth T-shirts with photographs of me on them, like as if I was a pop star.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's really cool. So you're not wearing your New York Marathon medal around the into the happy hour drinks, is that right?
It's heavy. So heavy.
Oh, no, I think it's, yeah. I don't think it's boastful. I think it's something to be proud of. It's really cool. Someone wanted to know... You may not be the right person to answer this, but what are the keys to a good retirement?
Yes,
that's you're struggling with it.
$64,000 question. I'm trying to give a Winston Peterson. If I had this one word, we're saying, you know, going to bed with something to look forward to the next day. So as you go to bed, you think, oh, tomorrow this is going to happen, or that's going to happen. You know, I think that's as long as I can do that, I'll be happy.
I like that. That's really cool. Like a purpose.
Yeah, yeah. But that's just, so sometimes I've got to wake up in the morning and open up my diary and see what I had planned for today. overnight.
I knew I had something to look forward to.
That's right. Yeah, no, what was it? Look at my electronic diary.
Yeah. Are you quite good with electronics and keeping up to date with everything? You're a very fast texter. Like if I message you, you text back very quickly.
Oh, okay. Yes. Well, some things I'm quite good at. Mm. But, you know, like I'm dealing with my car insurance, and last time I had to do anything, I was changing my address, and, of course, you just ring them up or send them that. But this time you can't. I thought, oh, I'll just send them a text or an email saying I've changed my address. But today this is AMI insurance, you know, mm-hmm. modern insurance company, and they don't have an email address to send things to. You had to register and become a registrant, and then you can do the next step. You had to be able to master the electronics to be able to communicate with your insurance company. Mm. You know, I tried ringing them, but of course they don't really want phone calls, you see, and it's lots of things like that. So you're forced a bit to, and I don't like sort of becoming a pest with my children. You know, oh, Dad's always asking me how to do this and how to do that. And, you know, yes, I think, well, they've got their own lives, not always coming to help us. So it's an effort to keep up, but I did manage. I said to my wife as I came out, I said, 1 hour changing my address with the insurance company. 1 hour, you know.
But at 88, you don't know how many hours you've got left.
Yeah, no, but, you know, but on the other side of the coin, I get the benefit in premiums lower than that they would otherwise be, you know.
Yeah.
See, I like that bit of it, but you got to do the effort. I can remember the fuss people came when they introduced the first electronic kiosks, you know, at the airport, you know. And now, of course, you can't do that yourself.
You know? Actually, that's a good point. That's something I didn't really think of, but it's yeah, and it, like you go into a, it's a, find a human being in a bank nowadays as well. Like
yeah, that's right.
You know. Everything's like steered away from even the supermarkets as well.
Yeah,
eh?
they really
want you to go to the automatic.
Yeah,
you
know, and I don't want to. When I was traveling with my friends and things, athletes, and that's all. Let's ask someone, and I said, no, don't have that sort of attitude. That's what gives old people a bad name. You know, they won't read the signs.
Yeah.
You know, let's try and work it out for ourselves before we have to ask someone. Mm. You know,
it's so hard though. It's daunting. Like the amount of change you've seen over your lifetime.
Oh yeah,
it's incredible. And just the last, I suppose, 15, 20 years, it's just been exponential. Eh?
Yeah.
Just how quickly things have changed.
Yeah.
Arch Jelly, who I mentioned before, like he's another one that's incredible with technology as well.
Yeah.
Like remarkable. Like he. Yeah. I mean, I could see myself calling him to ask him for advice on how to set up. He's that good. Like, it's inspiring, as you are. If you could go back in time and give advice to your younger self, what would it be?
Yes, I've been asked that one before, and I haven't got an answer off bat for that one, but
buy more property.
Yeah. Because you might think, oh, I had my time again, I wouldn't do this or I wouldn't do that. But you know, it's like me, if you like. I've been married twice. And if you said, well, do you regret your first marriage? And I said, well, perhaps I do, perhaps I don't. But you know, you do learn something from everything. I mean, or it gives you an experience that you wouldn't otherwise have.
Mm.
So I wouldn't use the word regret, but obviously I wouldn't have married the first wife again, but neither would she marry me. So you know, it's equal-handed, I wouldn't. You know,
Yeah. I think some of the greatest lessons you have in life come from your greatest failures, right?
Yeah, so, that's right. Yeah.
So being at a personal rock bottom, it's not a nice place to be. But when you get through it, you do realize you actually learn a lot from those experiences.
Yeah. Yes. Well, I remember. I think in the family, I got the name for reading the accident reports in the Herald. And they said, "Why do you read the accident?" Oh, I said, "So I can know what streets to avoid, or you know what not to do."
You know? What's the biggest adversities you faced in your life, professional and personal?
Oh well, of course, I had my disappointment of first marriage failing. That was a big disappointment to me. I mean.
How long? I don't think I knew that about you. How long have you been with your current wife for?
50 years.
50. So your three kids were with your first wife?
No, second wife.
Yeah. Right. How long was your first marriage?
Oh, about a couple of years.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Was that quite a big deal? Like having a failed marriage in like the 60s or 70s?
Oh, it was a big shame. Yeah. Well, I felt it was a big shame.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, she might have felt too that we're both free real adults. We made a mistake. But I don't, and not at that time it was, and then, you know, you sort of, you know, your friends got divided up a bit. You know? Not that there was any rancor, particular rancor anyway, but, you know, it was all experience.
Yeah. yeah, the fact that you've brought that up, it seems like it's still it still cuts deep, even though it's a long time ago and over half a life ago, and your second marriage has been very successful.
I would like going to Indonesia when I was 20, I suppose, and you know, I sort of went there with a mixture of idealism, you know, we were going to show the Indonesians that white men weren't all colonialists. Mm. If you like to use them, a bit of a mixture of modern lingo there, you know. Mm. You know, and part of the Colombo plan was part of the government's, it was a thing like that. But I can't say I accomplished a lot. I mean, I did the job, I was a tax inspector, but it was a really big sort of job. I just got transferred to another one. Mm. So military people had a lot of influence in those days. It was quite useful. I mean, when my parents came to visit me, and Bali was a historic tourist attraction, but it wasn't a tourist attraction at that time. Tourists could go there, but and then the army general that I taught English to, he arranged for me to buy a commercial flight, because I had to be friends with the army to get things done. So, get advantage of these things too.
Yeah. How's your mental health been over your life? Because I suppose when you were born in 1936 and growing up, that was a time when, like, there's a lot of awareness about mental health and depression now, but it wasn't sort of acknowledged as an actual thing, was it, really?
Yes. I can remember something was wrong with me, and someone suggested that I go to a shrink. I remember my business partner, Monty Thompson. Oh, that's ridiculous. If someone says Garth Barfoot, but weak in the head, they're out of their mind.
Yeah, that's funny. How do you keep your mind sharp and maintain your interests? Do you do anything? Do you do like crosswords or Sudokus or any word puzzles or anything like that to keep your mind sharp?
Well, my parents are very keen on Scrabble. Mm. And we were staying with our relations in Canada, and they had a Scrabble set, and because they get very long evenings in winter. But so they put Scrabble. And I say, when I play, I have this rule that you can't use a word unless you can use it in a sentence. And the judge on that is whether you can use it in a sentence if it appears in the New Zealand Herald.
Yeah.
Well, of course, the Canadians didn't like that rule very much because they don't get the New Zealand Herald
out there. You're stacking the game in your favour.
Well, so they had this thing, like, they had a dictionary, which was all it said was it was a Scrabble word, you know. Oh, this is a Scrabble word. This isn't a Scrabble word. Mm.
I love that. That's fun. It's cheeky.
Yeah, that's right.
What are you most grateful for at this stage of your life?
I'm grateful that I don't have debilitating health problems. I've had plenty of things wrong with me, but so far, they've been able to be fixed up, with hip operations, heart operations, so far they've been good. So that's been very lucky. I've got a heart. The last one was a heart pacer.
Have you got a pacemaker?
Yeah, pacemaker. You? Yeah, right. I mean, how many people have done the New York Marathon with a pacemaker? I'm just very grateful. I'm living in, people say the good old, the olden days. Well, I said, no, I don't want to live in the olden days. Yeah. I want to live these days of modern medicine. No, because they can keep me going,
Yeah, 100%. And what is your doctor and the medical staff that you see think about you doing endurance events like the marathon? Like, do they try and talk you out of it or do they think it's good for you?
Well, I try and avoid asking them.
Want to know that.
But sometimes I just say, well, I want to do the New York Marathon.
Yeah. Well, I think,
they go along with it, really. There's a lot more. I think the one who did the hip hop race and said, well, in the olden days, they wouldn't attempt to repair it. And you'd be bedridden. That's a phrase you don't hear these days. Bedridden. You know, he's bedridden, but you don't hear it. No such word, you know. And then, of course, eventually you get bed sores and infected and die of infection. And so the expectation is it's so much easier now when you're old that people accommodate you more, you know. And when I was young, you know, you retired at 60 or whatever it was and took your pension and had your obligatory trip to Europe and came back and died.
That's true.
It's a lot wider things. And you know, I quite like it. I don't think that I don't like the way that people go on about poor pensioners. You know, the pensioners aren't poor. They're very wealthy. Unless they mucked up their lives. Yeah. But, you know, I never liked pulling the...
Yeah, but you...
Pulling the thing. I mean, I still like to pay my own fare on the bus, you know, because I have to have that paid by the government. You know, I was on the rich list when the rich list was around. You know?
Yeah, but you don't live. Even though you're a rich lister, you don't live an extravagant lifestyle, do you?
Yeah, that's what someone said. I had that comment made before.
Yeah.
But I've never thought of it like that. If I want to travel to New York to do the marathon, I can. If I want to travel to Honolulu next month and do a marathon, I can. You know, but. All this sort of, and I tried cruising, and my wife and I, but we did one cruise, and that's about enough. I got dizzy walking around the swimming pool, you know. I get dizzy quite easily.
You got too bored. Yeah,
well,
yeah.
I wasn't quite bored, but, you know.
Actually, this jogs my memory. This came up last time we did the podcast. I asked you if you were flying I think you were off to London last time we did the podcast.
Yeah, yeah.
And I asked if you're flying business class, and you said in the previous flight where you went overseas, you were going to fly business class, but then you realised all your friends were flying premium economy and you didn't want to miss out.
Oh, so you
just flew in the cheaper seats with them because you didn't want to be lonely.
No, I had the same thing with a daughter. Business class is just money, but I can't buy the company of my daughter. Because someone said, well, then you can pay for your daughter's business class. Oh, I said, that's a bit much.
Was it? You can't take it with you when you're gone, though.
That's right, no. It's too late to change.
What about legacy? How would you like to be remembered?
Well, I seem to be remembered for the number of cycle tracks I've financially helped. And they've put a little shelters and things with my name on them. So
is that right? Whereabouts?
Our town, one down at Wanaka, it's in the South Island there, and one in the Rauakamaras in Gisborne behind the Apodiki. They're very grateful because they don't get – it's based in Gisborne, but Apodiki, but there's not a lot of charity money there.
Mm.
So and I'd done the rail trail or what it was, the old rail trail, and I thought it wouldn't take much effort to make a good job of this, you know. And there was a local group there, and they said my money was very useful down there. There wasn't much sort of charity money. So, and then I got involved in the one at Matakana. It was there. It was Alison Rose, she's not my coach, but she's in the running.
Oh, Alison Rowe.
Yeah.
Oh, have a word to her. Try and get her to come on the podcast. I'm a big fan of it. That's when I the year that she did the New York Marathon, was it 1981?
I think that's
the year that that was still televised at the time. I think there was only two TV channels in New Zealand. So I watched that on TV before going to school one morning, and it sort of that's I guess where my interest in running started. It was a very rich time for New Zealand running, right? There was her and was it Dick Quacks?
Rod Dixon.
New Zealand is winning the New York and Boston Marathon. Crazy. Like, it's just something you wouldn't see these days.
That's right. Yeah. No.
Yeah, back to the bike shelters and stuff. Yeah, you've been quite altruistic, haven't you? You've been quite generous.
Yeah.
And this is you personally. This is not through Barfoot and Thompson, which sponsored just about every bloody thing in Auckland. That's right. This is just you with your own money.
Yeah,
because last time we had you on the podcast, you'd bought a defibrillator machine for.
Oh yeah, okay.
For some outfit.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
What a legacy.
Yeah, so it's not big in themselves, but they all add up, you know.
Mm.
And of course, they like it a bit when there's a sort of name rather than a trust, you know.
Yeah.
It's Garth.
It's cool. It's satisfying, eh?
And I suppose I do. Mm. I do find it satisfying.
Yeah. There's a guy I had on the podcast called Dougal Allen, who's like a very good
multi-sport
legend.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. He's won Coast to Coast many times. Yeah. He's just recently won the America's Cup as one of the cyclores.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And when he was on the podcast, he was telling me he did an endurance event, and one of his teammates was Richie McCaw. And to get through the dark hours in the middle of the night, Richie asked them all to play a game where everyone had to give three words that they'd like people to use to describe them at their funeral.
Oh, okay.
And for Richie, one of the words that he gave for himself was integrity. And Dougal remembers thinking to himself, that's funny because that's exactly a word I'd use for Richie, having got to know him. So what would it be for you? What three words would you like people to describe you?
Well,
integrity would be one.
Yeah, I used to, partly because of my corporate life, I went to more funerals than the average person, and I'd come home and say, oh, Judy, I said, I think I'd like this. That was a good idea. I thought I'd like they did that. And she said, why are you telling me? So after a while I stopped. Yeah. But now you're suddenly asking me what three words you want people to describe. Oh, goodness knows. I'm not going to get in that track.
Is that something you think about much as you get to 88?
I think the funerals are getting too close for me to plan. It's nice planning them when they're a fair way away because it's like an academic exercise. Mm. But once they get a bit closer, I'm not too sure.
Yeah. And what about in terms of marathons? You just take them one by one now? So you're looking at doing a Honolulu?
But I have to. You know, I feel like I'm socially conscious, so I don't like doing things that put people out. I'm out a bit, of course, you know, but not, you know. So, and as I probably said earlier, I think I said earlier, you know, my preference now is for marathons without time cutoffs, because then I'm not hurting anyone, and they've got to have a lot of people in. Because some people say, well, they will get more people in a marathon, the more publicity you get. But the real reason is that there's more chance of people being slower than me.
Mm.
And a lot of them are quite altruistic and maybe they have to do it these days, but, you know, without being rude. But, I mean, it's good for me that they have disabled people or mentally handicapped people because, in general, they'll be slower. And that means it's easier for me. So it's a selfish way of looking at it. But it's true, though. You know, most of the people behind me in the New York Marathon, there's only about half a dozen, you know, had some what would have been regarded as a problem in the old days.
Yeah. I mean, it's fantastic that we live in a society now where
it accommodates, isn't it?
100%. 100%. You wouldn't be bothered about finishing like dead last, though, would you?
Oh, I used to say to people, If I am last, then the mantra is finishing is winning. And the other advantage is that means everyone in the race can go home and say to their people at home, I beat Garth Barfoot. So I can't lose, you see.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, like I love running. I'm the same as you. I love it. But I've never been very good at it, in that I'm never going to win an event. Yeah. And so far I've never been last in an event, okay. But I'd rather be last in an event than not running at all. Yeah. Like I think it's a privilege being out there.
Yeah.
Hey, Garth, this has been really neat catching up again. It's been cool. Mm-hmm. So proud of you.
Okay, totally good. Well, I've got to look at the clock because I've got a 5K race to do before the sun goes down.
Oh, you're off to a running event now.
It's 6 o'clock.
Hey, well, this is great. And, yeah, we'll have you on again maybe in another couple of years after you've done the 2026.
I can't think there's going to be anything fresh to say. Same old story.
Garth Barfoot, you're a great New Zealander. Thanks for coming on my podcast again.
Good. Thanks, Tom. Good.